I'm feeling so strong and alive. From this rocky perch, I continue to search for the wind and the snow and the sky. Oh, I want a lover and I want some friends, and I want to live in the sun, and I want to do all the things that I never have done. Sunny bright mornings and pale moonlit nights keep me from feeling alone. Now I'm learning to fly, and this freedom is like nothing that I've ever known. Oh, I've seen the bottom and I've been on top, but mostly I've lived in between. And where do you go when you get to the end of your the beating of that in the waves? And deep in my brain I can hear every frame of my soul as she rises and sings anthems to glory and anthems to love, and hymns filled with earthly delight, like the songs in the darkness. Once in a vision I came on stars and stood in a fork in the road. My choices were clear yet I froze with the fear of not knowing which way to go. The one road was simple, acceptance of life. The other road offered sweetness. When I made my decision,
good evening, friends. I'm Reverend Sarah Richards, minister here at Carbondale Unitarian Fellowship in Southern Illinois. I welcome all to this virtual memorial service for our dearly beloved Sandy Charlson. Welcome to you, watching from your homes, maybe in Iowa, where Sandy spent childhood and college life, in and around Carbondale, where she and Chris raised their two daughters, Hannah and Helen. From Logan, Utah, where the family is gathered tonight, from across the country and beyond its borders. Sandy made so many loving connections throughout her life. Please know that while this service is virtual, its meaning and its purpose are very real. To remember and give thanks for Sandy's life. During the inevitable delays and glitches because of technological and human limits, I encourage you to take those opportunities to breathe deeply and bring your patience and limitless love for Sandy into the moment. Let us begin with a prayer by Reverend Laura Horton Ludwig. Spirit of life, Spirit of love, we come today carrying our grief, our memories, and our love. We gather around screens and devices, reaching out with our minds and hearts to join in this most ancient of human customs, honoring one whom we loved who has died. In this moment, let us know that we are connected to all who have ever loved and mourned. Going back through countless generations, reaching back deep into time as time stops for a moment, and we are one with the eternal mystery of life and death. Breathing in the stillness, let us ground down and feel the deep earth supporting us, the trees overhead sheltering us, the sky above us all connecting us to the universe itself. We know so little of where we come from or where we will go when this life is done. But breathing in the stillness, may we know that we are one, that we are held, that love abides. Let us be in silence together, each adding our own silent prayers and meditations as our hearts lead us. May it be so. Amen. Sandy was a Unitarian Universalist for much of her adult life, and she contributed much to our liberal religious communities that she was a part of. It is fitting then to begin her memorial service by lighting a chalice, symbol of Unitarian Universalism. For our chalice lighting reading, Sandy's family adapted an excerpt from three elegiac poems by Wendell Berry. She goes free of the earth, the sun of her last day sets clear in the sweetness of her liberty. The earth recovers from her dying, the hallow of her life remaining in all her death leaves. Radiances know her. Grown lighter than breath, she is set free in our remembering. Grown brighter than vision, she goes dark into the life of the hill that holds her peace. She's hidden among all that is and cannot be lost. And I see that they've lit the chalice there in Utah. And if you have a chalice at home, I hope you have lit it or will do so. Our reading this evening was chosen and adapted from the song I've Got You by Camp Cope. Sandy's daughter, Hannah, will read it to us.
Thanks, Sarah. I chose this just because it's something that's spoken to me over the last few years as she was living with cancer. So here it is. It was the last time I felt like this. I felt nothing at all. I was 15 when you got sick. I still remember that phone call. They said there's something inside of you. So they tried radiation, chemicals too. And now you're standing on the last line. And so am I. I've got you. You've got me too. Oh, I've got you. And you said there's broken links in your brain. And I said, that's okay. Mine's exactly the same. There's still some things I don't understand, like the casual blindness towards the cruelty of man. And a cop shot the wrong guy again. They tore down a childhood home again. Oh, no one seemed to blink an eye when they wanted you to pay to see the sky. Running out of time. You're still running for your life. I know that when you go, part of me will go with you to the infinite unknown, and we'll stand at the edge of the divide. I will hold your hand, and together we'll dive. And I will never meet a soul that can make me question life the way you can, a defender of freedom, an advocate for truth. I'm so proud that half of me grew from you. All the broken parts too. I've got you. I will always hear your voice when I speak. I will always see your face in me. I will always hear your voice when I speak. I will always see your face in me.
We now have reflections from family members, beginning with the person who knew her the longest, her older brother, David.
Thanks, Sarah. Again, we're going to read some prepared texts, so bear with us. Hello, Carbondale. Hello, Knoxville. Hello, everyone far and wide. I am Sandra Charlson's big brother, as she called me, and also the first president of the Sandra Charlson fan club. More on that soon. Sandra credits me for always being there, from saving her tooth somehow after a childhood accident, to chasing away idiot boys on the great bike ride across Iowa when she didn't want to be disturbed. I don't remember all the times by now, but let me tell you the first time I realized she was pretty cool. It was prom night in Knoxville, Iowa, 1977, and I came home that night to find Sandra sitting with her friend Julie Bailey at our kitchen table, and they weren't looking too happy. Sandra said that they just wanted to dance. They didn't want to get drunk like everybody else, and I thought that was pretty cool for her to stand her ground and say so, and I marked that night as when she really emerged as someone who basically wouldn't take any frickin' crap from anybody. Her two daughters follow in her footsteps, let me tell you. Dan Fogelberg's song, Netherlands, opened the ceremony today. Let me tell you more about how Sandra chose that song. She did water ballet at Iowa State while I was working at my first real job out in New Jersey. But I flew back in secret to see her April show that spring. One of the numbers used Fogelberg's soaring song to great effect. And if you listen on a cheap laptop today, listen to it on a good sound system later. But it's an amazing song. With all the young swim ballerinas reaching to the sky, kind of like this. Except for their feet. Their legs. When the show was over, I joined several of her friends to surprise Greeter in my Sandra Charlson fan club t-shirt that I had made special in the Iowa State colors, cardinal and gold, yellow and red. And somehow I played that Dan Fogelberg song for Sandra this August, and it spoke to her all over again. She requested it to be a part of this ceremony as part of her embracing what she called her release, the key word from the final line of that song. That's sad for sure, but she fought harder than any of us know, I'm sure. After Iowa State, the amazing college town of Iowa City changed all our lives, where Sandra met her future husband, Chris Lant. But the first time Sandra and my mother visited me there, I was living there at the time, my mother at least was a little worried, for the town seemed to be not quite what she thought of as the usual Iowa crowd. Instead, downtown was full of hippies and dreadlocks and bare feet and freaky people everywhere with tie-dye. Can you guess why? Yes, there was a Grateful Dead concert in town that very night. So keep on trucking, Mom and Sandra. The last thing I'll share with you is what she did in Carbondale. What she made in Carbondale. What she built in Carbondale. A place for pure kids. In Sarah's church, and in her own house. She was our family's homesteader, a gardener too, and her house and yard were dedicated to providing a place for pure kids to play and grow and wonder and swing and climb trees, play some more and talk and have parties and sleep over and order Polly-Eyes pizza, too. For 20 years, she gave my own two kids and me a home away from home whenever we could visit, summers and holidays. There's a book on her bookshelf still that says, not natural childbirth, but natural childhood. And that's what she gave her kids and mine and yours, too, if they ever visited. She eventually even built a swimming pool in her backyard, for goodness sake, or for the sake of goodness, and even more water ballet. And here's my new word I just invented for when I see any house that seems friendly to all. Sandra-ness. I'll close now. Sandra and I rode Ragbray, the bike ride across Iowa with some of you in the 80s, her A-Team Purple. And then she got the idea for us to ride it again in the 20-teens, when I was bloody 60, this time with our kids. We did it, and I'll tell you, she was always ahead of me going up the hills this century, and she went ahead of me again, but we'll meet again, I imagine, further on down the road. Thanks to you all for being here and being hers. You still are. Thank you.
And now Sandy's soulmate and life partner, Chris, will share his reflections.
Hello, everyone, so from a sunny afternoon in Utah. So I'm Chris Lant, Sandy's husband of 32 years. I've ripped my thoughts and kept them short in hopes that I won't fall to pieces. As a few friends and family members know, and I was never secretive about it, my love name for Sandy was Sweeb, S-W-E-E-B, or sometimes Sweeby. I started calling her that very spontaneously about the time we were married in 1988, and it stuck across three decades. She occasionally called me Queeb, and when Hannah was born, we decided on Weeweeb. But those names didn't stick the way Sweeb did. I think that's because Sweeb evolved from just my nickname for my true love into a kind of colloquialism that took its place in a language that only I used and only immediate family knew. I'd like to use this occasion to reflect upon what Sweeb means. Sweeb is Sandy's unique essence. She has Sweeb. She is the Sweeb. Sweeb is an ability to live entirely in the moment with those in her company, even when her husband is incessantly planning his next move. Sweeb is a natural ability to completely enrapture others with her joyous presence. Sweeb is an instinct for motherhood, not only for her own two treasures, but of the entire neighborhood, the mother of the village. Sweeb is a stunningly beautiful feminine charisma. Sweeb is an ability to empathize with those most in need of loving attention. Sweeb is a visceral disgust for greed, self-centeredness, and most of all, meanness to or disregard for others. Sweeb is a colorful flower in bloom in a garden in full view that needs frequent watering, but even more, to be admired by passersby. Sweeb is having difficulty letting go of an old friend, a familiar place, even a routine possession, but also of being able to make new friends in new places with the spontaneous ease with which most of us walk down the street. Sweeb is a small town Midwestern pride, immersed in the local community and satisfied, even ever grateful, with the simple good things that life has to offer. Sweeb is a teacher with sage on the stage charisma, but also with an understanding for each student as an individual who will never forget her. Sweeb is an artist who exalts in the beauty of the useful and the utility of the beautiful. Sweeb is a fighter, like her heroine Ruth Bader Ginsburg, against the most deadly disease known to humans, inspiring others with her positive energy and optimistic spirit, even as the chances of victory grew vanishingly small. Sweeb is an ability to know when that battle is over and the time to say goodbye has come. Sweeb is a spouse fully worthy of the old wise vow, in sickness and in health, do death to us part. Sweeb is Sandy's unique essence. She has Sweeb. To me, she is and will always be the Sweeb.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you. and all that we can be, not what we
are. Our last reflection is from Sandy's daughter, Helen.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sandy's younger daughter, Helen. Many of you know that my mom reached her absolute pinnacle and prime of her life in her 40s and 50s in Carbondale, Illinois, where she and my dad lived from 1989 to 2015, about 27 years. This was where my sister and I were born and raised. This was the place where Sandy involved herself in every community facet possible and made friends with every single damn person that she met. They moved away when I turned 18, but we all very much still consider Carbondale to be home. A few years ago, I was living in Carbondale for the summer and my mom came to visit. Every single day was booked with social gatherings, hikes, and parties in order to maximize her Carbondale experience while she was there. I remember my good friend Nick, astounded by her energy during this nonstop week, at one point turning to me and saying, "I think I have witnessed full throttle Sandy." The words "full throttle Sandy" have stuck with me, and I want to talk about the ways in which this uniquely energetic woman was always on. My mom was a full-throttle community member. She was a dedicated professor who saw the individual life story of each of her students. She was an active member of our UU church and beloved by the entire congregation, where she taught Sunday school for years. And she was on the school board at our elementary school. She was at every PTA meeting and school party and did recess duty, where every time she was there, a throng of kids would run up and hug her. Sandy's feminism said, "You really can do it all." My mom listened to music at full throttle. Her taste in music was geared towards deeply emotional and cathartic, as you may have already perceived from this service, and she would never play me a song without first telling me what specific memory it was tied to and what it meant to her. My mom was full throttle energetic. She was an avid swimmer and a lifeguard throughout high school and college. She rode her bike 500 miles across Iowa nearly every year during her 50s. She grew a beautiful, if not a little disorganized, garden. She cooked and preserved food like a madwoman, and she ate infinite slices of Polly's pizza. One of my dad's nicknames for her was Flying Limbs, which I may have inherited. My mom was full throttle sentimental. I have made fun of her my entire life for the amount of keepsakes she held onto, but now as an adult, I'm grateful that we have my essays from middle school and my baby shoes and even Hannah's and my umbilical cords that we keep in little ceramic turtle shells. Yes, she was weird. My mom was always in full throttle party mode. We threw a 4th of July party every year, which was maybe focused more on being together in summer than on undying patriotism. She threw Hannah and I birthday parties every year that turned from small-scale scavenger hunts with a few kids to legendary midnight hide-and-seek parties, where her rule was, invite whoever the hell you want, but you're all staying outside. Every year at these parties, she would have a white tablecloth that every kid would sign, and she would hand embroider every single signature over the following year. Who the hell has that kind of dedication except for Sandy motherfucking Charlson? And did I mention that she swore like a sailor? But the fullest throttle Sandy was found in motherhood. In all of the dozens of condolence notes that I've received this week, the through theme of all of them have been, Sandy was like a second mother to me. She opened her arms and doors to all the children of the world, whether they were Hannah's and my closest friends, or the weird kids at school who no one else was nice to, which, let's be honest, were often the same people. She raised Hannah and I with a delicate attentiveness that has left us deeply nourished, loved, and uplifted without spoiling us. She taught us to be generous, non-entitled, and kind. She encouraged us in school without doing any of it for us. She was friends with all of our friends without being one of those cool moms who was stuck in high school. She was endlessly attentive without being a worrier or a helicopter. She had hard and fast rules about the TV while letting us run into the woods whenever we wanted, and was somehow delighted when we'd come home covered in mud or deer ticks. And if you hung out with me and Hannah as kids, you probably remember her famous phrase, "The dirtier the kid, the better the day." And finally, Sandy was full throttle in her death. For 3 years, she fought one of the most deadly forms of cancer with grace, positivity, and even occasional enjoyment. She found a new part of herself in her strength and resolve in the face of mortality. And finally, when she knew the battle was over, she threw her hands to the sky, said a final farewell to the thousands of people who loved her, and died 3 days later, almost unexpectedly, like diving off a board into her beloved hometown swimming pool. A full throttle life met with a full throttle death. Since she died almost a week ago, I felt this hum inside of myself that might just be a small echo of her indescribable light. Thank you.
Thank you, Helen. I invite you all now into a moment of silent meditation to remember Sandy and the many and varied ways her life touched our lives. Spirit of life and love, the spirit of Sandy Charlson that filled our world with love and delight, has become one with eternity. We are grieving. May we gain a sense of comprehending compassion. May our hearts be mended in time. May the love in our hearts join us together in richer ways than before, and in time lead us to the peace that passes understanding. We know that Sandy's spirit will always be with us in her sweetness and her full throttledness, in her Sandra-ness. Her love for us and our love for her will never die. May it be so. Friends, we give thanks for the life of Sandy Charlson, and we give thanks for her ways that made Carbondale and Logan and Ames and Iowa City and all the communities she was a part of better places to live and to learn and grow. We give thanks for her friendship, concern, and love that filled our lives. May we who mourn Sandy's death be granted the gifts of understanding and acceptance, and may we truly find our sense of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving for a good and wild and loving life lived fully and fruitfully. We give thanks that Sandy was and is a part of our common life. The truth of her life endures, for it is woven into the interdependent web of existence of which we are all a part. And now, as we remember and say farewell to one held so dear, let us be confident and trusting that a human life is full of meaning and purpose, even in death. Let us contemplate all of these things as we listen to the UU hymn, Wake Now My Senses. I guess it's a favorite of Sandy's because her family selected it. It's a common favorite. Under normal circumstances, at this point, I'd invite everyone gathered to join the family in the Fellowship Commons for a reception. That's not possible right now, but per her wishes, I invite you all to the celebration of life and potluck for Sandy at Carbondale Unitarian Fellowship next year, when it is safe for us to gather together, to hug and to hold hands. After the benediction, we'll wave farewell to the folks in Utah, and then hopefully listen to Kendall Bell singing Keep Me in Your Heart by Warren Zevon. Kendall was a close friend of Hannah's in religious education at the fellowship, and therefore was one of those people mothered by Sandy, remaining friend of the family into adulthood. And now please take a deep breath with me. If you are with someone at home, please hold hands or lift your palms to receive and to give the benediction. These words are from the choral benediction that we regularly sing here at the fellowship. And just last Saturday, many of us gathered here to sing it to Sandy with our messages of love and care. And now we speak these words for each other. May the blessings of love rest upon you. May peace abide with you. May love's presence illuminate your heart now and forevermore. Amen. Blessed be.
Keep the fires lit.